Então, lembrando que o Our Blog vai falar de falhas de mercado, não existem.
Obrigado, Walter.
Let's check the microphone. Okay.
You heard everybody there? Yesterday I spoke about libertarianism, and I try to distinguish it between libertarianism and economics. Today, my topic is Austrian economics, and I've already distinguished it from libertarianism. So now what I'd like to do is explain what is Austrian economics, and to distinguish it not from libertarianism, but from other kinds of economics. And then what I'll do is I'll apply it to public goods, which seems to be of interest. So what is Austrian economics? Austrian economics has got nothing to do with the economics of the country Austria. The reason it's called Austrian economics is that the people who started it were Menger, Bombeverk, Mises, Hayek, all who lived in Austria. Similarly, the Chicago School of Economics with Milton Friedman and Ronald Coase and George Stigler has got nothing to do with the economics of Chicago, the city in the US, but it's just because they all were at the University of Chicago. That's why the name. Okay, now what is the essence of Austrian economics? The way I see it, and they say if you have 10 Austrian economists in the room, you'll have 11 views about what Austrian economics is. So this is my view. My view is there may be 15 different things about Austrian economics. One of them is praxeology, another is Austrian business cycle theory, another is the non-neutrality of money, spontaneous order, entrepreneurship, ordinal versus cardinal, transitivity, antitrust, utility and welfare economics, market process, socialism, capital being heterogeneous, not homogeneous, structure of production, indifference. I'm just reading the list. Now I'll try to explain each one. The first one is praxeology. To me, this is the most important thing. This is the essence of Austrianism. Everything else follows from this. And what is praxeology? Praxeology says that economics is not an empirical science. You have a hypothesis. Water runs downhill. Water is two parts hydrogen and one part oxygen. You have a hypothesis, then you test it. And the logical positivists, they were a theory in philosophy, said that all science should be like this. That you make a hypothesis and you test, and if it doesn't fail, then you accept it provisionally. We don't accept it as a necessary law, but just provisionally. Even gravity, tomorrow gravity could be proven wrong. We have to be open. That's what science is, that's the way empirical science is. Austrianism is very different. We don't believe, at least in my view, we don't believe that it is based on hypotheses, but rather it is based on law, apodictic law, law that to deny it is a self-contradiction. Praxeology says economics is not really a branch of physical science, rather it's a branch of logic, like symbolic logic, or geometry, or things like that. Let me give you some examples. If I trade you my tie for your pen, this is your pen, this is my tie, why am I doing it? Because I like something about this pen more than the tie. Now, it might be I don't like this pen, but I think if I make the trade, you'll be my best friend forever. Who knows the reason? All I know is that I'm willing to make the trade, so I benefit, I make a profit to the difference between how I evaluate the pen and the tie. You, on the other hand, you're giving me the pen and I'm going to give you the tie. There must be something about this tie you prefer more than the pen. And you make a profit of the difference between the value that you place on these things and I make a profit between the value I place on these things. And that's a law. You can't test this. If you try to test this and the test shows that this is wrong, the test is wrong. This is right. This is an economic law, that when voluntary trade takes place, each person values it in the opposite way, the two items, and each makes a profit. That's it, period. If you understand English or Portuguese, you understand that this is undeniable. Let me give you some other examples. There's a tendency for profits to equalize in all industries, assuming equal risk. Which means if the profits in cars is high and the profits in computers is low, money will flow toward the higher profit. There's a tendency for the price of the same thing to be the same price everywhere. Are those Marxists objecting to what I'm saying? I don't know. A tendency can't be falsified. Because if the price of a pen is high here and low there, that it's not falsified. Because we're only saying there's a tendency for them to be equal, assuming transportation costs and other things like that. So these are laws. Now, there are some people that say, oh, you're being too omniscient. You're not thinking that maybe Descartes was right, we're all falling asleep, we're all fooled. Austrians are not omniscient. We say we could be mistaken. Anyone could be mistaken about anything, even these laws. All we're saying is that these laws are equivalent to the Pythagorean theorem in the triangle, a right triangle, the square of the sides equals the square of the hypotenuse, or that a triangle has 180 degrees, or things like that. We could be in error about that too. We have to be modest in our proposals. But what we're saying is that economics is a branch of logic. It's not an empirical science. And for this reason, people call us a religion or a cult. Milton Friedman said that when two Austrian economists disagree, they can only fight, physical fight. Can you imagine two old fat economists fighting? I mean, it's silly. Any more than when two geometricians disagree or two mathematicians disagree, they don't have to fight. And yet, the mainstream neoclassical economists, they dismiss Austrianism on the grounds that praxeology is the essence of it, and it's a religion, it's a cult, and that's their view. My PhD dissertation advisor at Columbia was Gary Becker. Gary Becker is a very famous economist. He's a neoclassicist. He was at Columbia when I was there, and then he went to Chicago, where he got his PhD. And he's now one of the leaders of the Chicago School. And I did my dissertation on rent control with him. And most of the times, I had an econometric regression equation model. And most of the times, I got significant results. The t-values were significant at the 5% level, like a good statistical econometrician. And the signs were correct, namely, the more rent control, the worse housing was. But every once in a while, I ran many, many regressions, and every once in a while, I got the wrong sign, and every once in a while, even worse, it was statistically significant. So did Gary Becker say, oh, I got this genius, Walter Block, he's gonna show that everything we know about rent control is wrong? No, he didn't say that. He said, Block, you idiot, go out and do it again until you get it right. So what was testing what? Was my stupid econometric statistical results testing the theory? Or was the theory testing the results and the law? It wasn't testing the law, it was illustrating it. So what we Austrians say is that econometric statistical work can illustrate the law, but the law is the law. The law cannot be denied. Okay, that's the most important part of Austrianism, and now there are two schools of Austrianism, because there are certain Austrians who either disagree with this, like Hayek, or who don't think it's very important, like the people at the George Mason University. They have an Austrian PhD program, but they don't think it's that important. They don't stress it. You ask them what are the top 15 things about Austrianism, they wouldn't mention praxeology. Whereas to me and the Rothbardians and the Misesians, it's very important. This is the essence of Austrian economics. I think Hayek is a very, very good Austrian economist, not because of praxeology, but because of his contributions to the structure, production, and Austrian business cycle theory. But as far as being a pure Austrian, he's not. And as far as being a libertarian, he's horrible. He wrote this book, Road to Serfdom, and I have a vicious attack on him for compromising, giving away the store, and all sorts of compromises. So he's a very poor libertarian, but he's a good, pretty good B-minus Austrian. Even though he's the only Austrian who won the Nobel Prize, for me, praxeology is the key, and he rejects it. He says, I don't go along with Mises on this. Okay, the next thing is the Austrian business cycle theory. We are very different than the Keynesians. The Keynesians think that the economy is sort of like a car. If it's going too slow, you put the gas on. If it's going too fast, you put the brakes on. And the central planning people can run the economy. And when we have a depression, we have more government spending. And when we have a inflation, we have less. Arthur Burns, who was Murray Rothbard's teacher at Columbia, was the head of the Federal Reserve System. And he was once asked, well, what about if you have both? What about if you have inflation and depression? And he said, well, then we'll have to resign. Which is the only honest thing he could say, because if you have stagflation, namely inflation and depression at the same time, what can the Keynesians do? If they push up to help unemployment, then they hurt inflation. If they push down, then they help inflation, but they hurt unemployment. They should all resign. But nobody ever resigns. The Austrian theory is not a theory of macro. It's more of a micro theory of the business cycle. It doesn't say that the reason we have unemployment is because we have less aggregate demand or not enough aggregate demand. It says it's a misallocation theory. What it says is that when you have an artificial lowering of the interest rate, what this does is it encourages all investment because it makes future goods worth more at present. Money receivable in the future at a lower interest rate is worth more than heavily discounted money receivable in the future. In other words, money receivable in a year from now at a 10% interest rate is worth roughly 90 cents now, right? Because if you put 90 cents in the bank now at 10%, you can get about a dollar. So what the essence of the Austrian business cycle theory is that when they artificially lower the interest rate, what they do is they make all investment worth more because investment is money receivable in the future. But they make money receivable in the very short future, a year or two, worth just a little bit more money, whereas money receivable in 20 years is worth a lot. So entrepreneurs are led by an invisible hand to overproduce long-term capital and underproduce relatively short-term capital. So you have a misallocation. Too many cars and houses, because cars and houses take many years to build from scratch, and not enough pens or, apples, or, well, maybe not apples, but bread from wheat. So it's a misallocation. That's why we have a housing crisis. In the U.S. and in many other countries, because housing is very long-term, and interest rates caused overinvestment in housing and underinvestment in other things, and what the market is trying to do is get back, and they keep propping up prices. They keep propping up housing prices, labor prices, and they keep prolonging the depression just like they did in the 1930s. Tom Woods has a very good book on this called Meltdown, which explains all this stuff very well, and it comes from Hayek, Prices and Production, 1931, Mises, Rothbard, all wrote very good books on this. Okay, the next one is the non-neutrality of money. When they increase the money supply, all prices rise higher than they otherwise would have been. And we never know what the prices otherwise would have been, so it's non-testable, it's non-falsifiable. Prices are higher than they otherwise would have been, but it's not that the prices all go up at the same rate. Some prices go up more than other prices, so it's non-neutral. The people who get the money first, the banks, the crony capitalists, spend it in certain ways, and those prices rise, and then other people get have the old money, and they lose because some prices are higher, and their salaries aren't high yet. And the people who lose are the people on fixed incomes, the proverbial widows and orphans. Another one is spontaneous order. This is what the people at the George Mason, they think that this is the essence of Austrian economics. I think it's an important part, but it's not really the essence. For me, the essence is praxeology. By the way, before I continue, I just wanted to mention one more thing. Yesterday, there was a very important question asked by one of the people in the audience, and I misunderstood it because they talked about subjectivism. And what this young person said was that I'm contradicting myself. On the one hand, I said it's an empirical issue. We don't know whether intellectual property will lead to more or less innovation. On the one hand, if you give people a patent, it will increase incentives to innovate. On the other hand, if you have patents, then you can't directly invent. You have to go through other patents. So it's hard to tell. You can't say for sure. On the other hand, I said that if you had a system of free enterprise where anyone could set up a bus line, and some people were prejudiced against black people and wouldn't let them sit in the front of the bus, then other people would set up bus companies and would solve the problem. So the contradiction is, on the one hand, I say I can't tell, and on the other case, I say I can tell. But it's not a contradiction, because this is an empirical issue where we don't have any law, whereas this is not an empirical issue. This is a law-like idea, namely, the higher the profits, the more investment we'll get in a given area, other things equal. So if some people are mistreating blacks, and now there's a gap, a profit gap, other people will come in to take advantage of that. So I haven't contradicted myself, and I apologize because I did not really understand the question. But this sort of illustrates the Austrian view. Okay, the next one is entrepreneurship. Entrepreneurship is very, very important. You look at the microeconomics textbooks, and they mention land, labor, and capital. And if you look in the index, maybe there'll even be a mention of entrepreneurship, and maybe not. But for the Austrians, the entrepreneur is crucial. The entrepreneur allocates resources, tries to make a profit, engages in the spontaneous order, the Adam Smith invisible hand. The invisible hand, where Adam Smith and the Austrians thought it was God's hand leading us to do what the people wanted. For example, if we decide we're too fat and we really want to have more carrots and less chocolate, we want to go on a diet, do we have to ask Obama or the president of Brazil, please tell the farmers to produce more carrots and less chocolate? No. We just start buying carrots and stop buying chocolate. And the prices of chocolate go down, and the profits in chocolate go down, and the prices of carrots go up, and the profits in carrots go up, and resources go from chocolate to carrots, and it's automatic. This is the invisible hand, this is the spontaneous order. Other examples of the spontaneous order are language. No government created language. Language just erupted from below. Another one is money. How did we come up with gold as money? Well, gold beat out carrots and chocolate to intermediate trade. The problem with barter is the double coincidence of wants. I have a chicken and I want a pickle. I have to find someone who has a pickle and wants a chicken. Very difficult. So what I do is I take my chicken and I buy salt, and everyone uses salt, and then I go and buy a pickle. So I make two trades instead of one, and salt was a money, and bananas aren't really a good money because they deteriorate. And concrete isn't a good money because it's not valuable. And diamonds are a horrible money even though they're valuable. But when you try to make change in a diamond, you lose value. If you break up a diamond in half, it's not worth, the two little diamonds aren't worth the same as the big diamond. Whereas gold, you can break it up easily. You can tell whether it's legitimate or not much more easily. It's valuable. So these are instances of spontaneous order. The next element of Austrian economics I want to go over is ordinal and cardinal. What is the difference between ordinal and cardinal? Ordinal is ordering. I like apples better than bananas, and I like bananas better than carrots. Fine. There's no problem with that. But cardinal means counting utils or counting utility. It's saying apples have 10 utils, bananas have 5 utils, and therefore I like apples twice as much as bananas. That's crazy. That's lunacy. That's what the neoclassicals do. There's no such thing as utils. Now, we're not against measurement. There's height, there's weight, there's speed. There's all sorts of measurement, temperature, right? Celsius, Fahrenheit, there are measurements. But happiness doesn't have a measurement. And to think that you can have a measurement in happiness units is preposterous. And yet this is the neoclassical view. And this neoclassical view pervades everything. For example, it pervades antitrust. Antitrust regulation, anti-monopoly regulation, is based on the fact that the monopolist is withholding, isn't producing as much as we think he should be producing. We think central planners, the antitrust people, we say that IBM should produce 100 units, and they're only producing 80 units to raise the prices. And somehow we know they should produce 100 units. And what we're saying, the antitrust people, is that we, the people, value the extra 20 units more than the costs. And they're not producing it. But this is cardinal utility. What you're doing is making interpersonal comparisons of utility, which is even worse. What you're saying is not only do I like apples at 10 and bananas at 5, and therefore apples are twice as good as bananas, but I'm saying I like apples at 10, you like bananas at 20, and therefore you get twice as much value out of apples as I do, or out of bananas. I'm getting all confused with my examples here. But the point I'm trying to make is that you not only can't you compare within a person, intrapersonally, for the value of different things, but to make an interpersonal comparison is grotesque. Who is the tennis champ now? Djokovic. And he only plays 10 tournaments a year. I'm making up the number. And according to antitrust, he should play 15. Because we value the extra 5 tournaments more than he disvalues the extra 5 tournaments. And if we applied antitrust to him, we would make him play more tennis. On the ground that this interpersonal comparison of utility, that's exactly what they do with businesses. Poor Bill Gates was working in Seattle, way away from Washington, D.C. And the problem with him is he wasn't paying off the boys in Washington, Democrats and Republicans. So they said, he has a lot of nerve. He's got to pay us. We'll get antitrust on him. And as soon as he started giving money to Washington, D.C., no more antitrust. Murray Rothbard used to say that when you had the Rockefeller president, they would attack the Morgan companies. And when you had the Morgan president, they would attack the Rockefeller companies, all based on antitrust. Antitrust is just a political thing. But the economists have this view that we can justify it on the basis of interpersonal comparisons of utility. I once told this joke. Let me tell this joke to you now. I told it to a bunch of economists and lawyers, all in antitrust. And by the way, I have a college roommate who used to specialize in money. And he said, there's no money in money, which means monetary economists don't make much money, whereas antitrust economists make a lot of money. because they testify in, for the offense or the defense, for the plaintiff, for the defendant. They make a lot of money. So here's the joke. There were three prisoners in Russia under the Soviet Union, and they were all in jail. And as prisoners do, you jailbirds know, you compare notes. Why are you in prison? Why are you in prison? So the first one says, I was in jail because I came to work late, and they accused me of cheating the state out of my labor services. Second guy said, I came to work early every day, and they accused me of brown nosing. You know what brown nosing is? You know, I don't know if it's being lost in translation, being too nice. The third guy said, I came to work every day exactly on time, and they accused me of owning a Western wristwatch. And this audience gave a big laugh. Then I told the second part of the joke, and there was dead silence. And I said, there were three prisoners in the U.S., all guilty of antitrust violations. And the first one said, I charged too high a price, and they accused me of profiteering. The second guy said, I charged too low a price, and they accused me of cutthroat competition and predatory pricing. And the third guy said, I charged the same price as everyone else. It's hard to see how he did, given these other two guys, but you know, it's just a joke. Work with me here. And they accused me of cartelization. Dead silence. They didn't like that joke. Because it shows that antitrust is just nonsensical. I mean, look, the whole purpose of law is if you break the law, we throw you in jail. If you don't break the law, we don't throw you in jail. If you murder, you go to jail. If you don't murder, you're innocent. If you rape, you go to jail. If you don't rape, you don't go to jail. But here, no matter what you do, high price, low price, the same price, you go to jail? What kind of a law is that? And yet the mainstream neoclassical Chicago school, which is supposed to be free enterprise, they favor this crap. The only thing they do is they say, this shows how free enterprise they are. They say, well, we shouldn't have all the antitrust cases that we have because antitrust costs money. And if the deadweight loss, the interpersonal comparisons of utility laws is small and the cost of the lawsuit is big, then we shouldn't do it. Well, okay, that's good, but it's hardly free enterprise. Whereas the Austrian is very, very free enterprise, saying antitrust is dead from the neck up. It's just silly. Here's another aspect of Austrian economics. It's called transitivity. Transitivity. What's transitivity? Transitivity is if 5 is bigger than 4, and 4 is bigger than 3, therefore 5 is bigger than 3. Fine. But then they apply it to apples, bananas, and carrots, A, B, C. They say if apples are better than bananas, and bananas are better than carrots, therefore apples are better than carrots. No. Because when you choose between apples and bananas, it's at one point of time. When you choose between bananas and carrots, it's at another point of time. And now you're choosing between apples and carrots, it's at a third point of time, and you could have changed your mind. It's just like in teams in soccer, team A beats team B, team B beats team C. Does team A always beat team C? No. Sometimes team C beats team A because of the personnel or whatever. They had a bad day, who knows? Transitivity doesn't work, whereas these people have a religious fetish about transitivity. Another one is market process and equilibrium. Now, I'm attacking the George Mason Austrians, who are impure Austrians, and for them, market process is the key. They even had a journal called Market Process. Whereas for the Rothbardian, Misesian Austrians, market process is one of the 15 or 20 things that distinguishes Austrianism from neoclassical, but it's not the essence of it. So what is market process? Market process is the emphasis on markets as opposed to equilibrium. In equilibrium situations, there's no profit. Equilibrium is where the market is always aiming toward, but never reaching because things keep changing. So what these neoclassicals do is they study intensively what is true and what is not true at equilibrium. Well, it's of interest. But that's all they do. They don't talk about anything else, hardly. They just talk about what's true or not true at equilibrium, and we're never at equilibrium, overall equilibrium. We're always moving in the direction of equilibrium, so market process stresses that the market is always in a state of flux or a state of process. We're never fully at equilibrium. Another one is socialism. Mises wrote a book on socialism. And here you have three problems of socialism. One problem of socialism is incentives. And everybody knows that if you pay people equally, everybody equal, and no matter how hard you work and how smart you work, you get paid the same, then your incentives to work hard and to work smart are lessened. So that's one problem with socialism or egalitarianism. Another problem with egalitarianism is that they're hypocrites. If you look at an egalitarian in the eye and he has two eyes, you know he's a hypocrite. Because there are people with no eyes. Why isn't he giving them one eye? You see, they talk about money. We have to take money from the rich and give it to the poor. Yeah. How about something important, like an eye? Or IQ points. Suppose we had a machine, you put a person in with a 150 IQ, and you put another person in the machine with 100 IQ, and you flip a switch, and they both come out with an IQ of 125. You ask these egalitarians, and many of them are very smart professors with 150 IQ, but no common sense, would they go into that machine? Would they put their kids in that machine? And if they're honest, they would say no. See, the idea here is diminishing marginal utility of money. The point is, the first $1,000 you make is very important. It's the difference between life and death. The second $1,000 you make is less important. When you make $1,000,000 and you light your cigars with $100 bills, the $100 bill is not worth much. So what we do is we take $100 from a rich person who doesn't really value that $100 much because of the diminishing marginal utility of money, and we give it to the poor person who values it very much, right? And then one of the market failures is called unequal income distribution. And the solution is to take money from rich and give it to poor. Because of this interpersonal comparison of the value of a dollar. But this is silly. Maybe the very rich guy who lights his cigar with the $100 bill gets great pleasure out of that lighting of the cigar with $100. And maybe the poor person is going to just gamble it away or get drunk or something like that. And he's better off without the $100. You can't tell. There's no scientific way of telling this. Okay, so one problem with socialism is incentives. Then the second problem mentioned by Hayek is lack of knowledge. If we're all businessmen, we're all workers here, and we go to Brasilia, the capital of Brazil, and we tell them what's going on, what are there, 200 million people in Brazil? Hayek says, the phone lines and the computers would be clogged up with all sorts of information. And a lot of the information is tacit, not explicit. For example, if you're going to tell somebody how to get to your house where you've been living for 20 years, it would be very hard for you to tell them. You know, go down Route 5 and then Maple Avenue and then 14th Street. You don't know that. You just automatically go to your house, right? So if you're a businessman and you know that Joe is a better worker than Harry, how are you going to give that information to Brasilia in a way that they'll know it? And how will they be able to trust the information that they're given? Much better, you employ Joe and not Harry, and if you profit, then your information gets inputted into the economy. So this is the Hayekian criticism of socialism, and I think it's a good criticism. Mises gives a different criticism I think it's complementary, namely the two go together, although there's dispute over this. Some people say Hayek isn't really worth that much on this. I think he is. And what Mises says is that central planning without prices is irrational. There's a certain irrationality of the economy. For example, you want to make a railroad track. And what's the best metal for a railroad track? Platinum. Let's say it's better than steel. But platinum has alternative costs that are much higher, so we don't make railroad tracks out of platinum. It's very important to have prices that indicate scarcities and consumer desires. And if we don't have it, then Mises says we're planning irrationally. We're just arbitrarily deciding what to do. So the obvious criticism of this is, well, if the Soviet Union can't plan rationally, how did it last for 70 years, from 1917 to 1987, roughly, or 1989, whenever it fell apart? And the answer is that they did have prices, not Soviet prices, but they had the Sears and Roebuck catalog, and they could find out the prices of the Chicago Mercantile Exchange. Namely, they had some prices, so they weren't going to use platinum for railways, because they knew that the prices of platinum were way higher than the price of steel. But if we had world socialism, and now socialism, you see, there are two ways to define socialism. One is government ownership of the means of production. And if there was a world government and there was no stock market and no, you could own a pen and you could own a tie and you could own your own bicycle, but you can't own steel or plastic or any means of production, and there are no prices, and you can't get the prices from somewhere else, well then you would have irrationality. And Murray Rothbard, in his magnificent book, Man, Economy, and State, talks about one big firm. Suppose we have mergers. Microsoft merges with U.S. Steel, merges with General Motors, all the companies merge, and now you have one big firm in the whole world. And Murray says that this too would be inefficient, because then you wouldn't have any buying and selling. You'd just have one firm. So there's a limit to how big a firm can get in the free enterprise system without antitrust. The other way of defining socialism is not the government ownership of the means of production, but from each according to his ability, to each according to his need. It's another way of defining socialism. And in my view, we can have such a thing called voluntary socialism. For example, you could have a kibbutz or a condominium or a cooperative or a family. The little girl in the family does not eat food in accordance with her ability to earn income. She eats food in accordance with her need. Right? So there is such a thing as voluntary socialism. So one of the things that I use in my debates with socialists is I say, well, are you a coercive socialist or a voluntary socialist? Do you want to impose your view on everyone, or do you just want to use it for you and your friends who agree? So I think it's very important to make a distinction between coercive socialism, where you impose things on people, innocent people, against their will, and voluntary socialism, which the family uses, or the club, or whatever. It's on a voluntary basis. Somebody during the break asked me, well, what do I think of affirmative action, giving people a break, black people, poor people, whatever. And my view on that now, as a libertarian, not as an Austrian economist, we have to make that distinction, is if it's voluntary, it's fine. If you want to hire a black person even though he can't do the job and you'll make a little bit of a loss, God bless, go do it. But don't force other people to do it. Okay, the next one is structure of production. I'm sort of ignoring this market failure and public goods, because I gave my notes to somebody and they didn't give it back, because I wasn't prepared to speak now. I was supposed to speak this afternoon, but I'll try to wing it or go by whim or something. But let me just do structure of production and then indifference, and then I'll try to hack away at that problem. For the mainstream economists, for the neoclassical economists, capital is just a homogeneous good, K. They put K in their equation, and that's what capital is. Whereas for the Austrians, we have this thing called structure of production. There's different kinds of capital. Capital is heterogeneous. It's not homogeneous. It's not just one blob of clay where you can mold the clay causelessly into anything you want. Rather, there's some capital that's good for mining, big things that break up the earth. They're no good for other things. There's a scalpel for a surgeon, and then there's a bludgeon. And the two are very different things. And once the metal is poured into a scalpel for a doctor or a surgeon, or into a pick and shovel, you can't convert them. And if you have too many scalpels and not enough picks and shovels, or the reverse, that's no good. And here you have the triangle, the very famous triangle of, I forget who started it. I have an article on that where we trace it back 100 years or so. But the first one that I ever read was Hayek and Prices and Production. And Rothbard has got this, where, and Roger Garrison has done great work with the triangle, where the early stages of production, mining, manufacturing, are different than the later stages, and the wholesaling is different than retailing. And you have to look at the structure of production, not just capital as a homogeneous good. And that's part of the Austrian business cycle theory, to show that the interest rates pervert the triangle, twists the triangle out of shape. And what the depression part of the business cycle is an attempt on the market to get the triangle back. Ah, I got my notes back. Ah, bless you. Thank you. These are my notes that I was going to try to get on the board, but now I can see what I'm doing. Okay, one last thing is indifference. The mainstream love indifference curves. Maybe the perverts, sexual perverts, because the curve goes like that, and they love this curve. We ought to get a Freudian to analyze these people. I mean, they call us cultists, so I can call them stuff too, perverts, whatever. The indifference curve, if any of you have taken any mainstream courses in microeconomics, the indifference curve is a big thing. And for the Austrians, indifference is a very problematic concept. Now, we all know what indifference is in ordinary language. If I say, you know, do you want this pen or the other pen, and they're giving out these pens with your free pens, which pen do you want? You say, I don't care, just give me a pen. They're all the same. So we know what indifference is. It's a perfectly good English word, and I'm sure there's a Portuguese word for indifference too. But as a matter of technical economics, you cannot demonstrate indifference. Because in commercial activity, all you can do, says Mises, is preferring and setting aside. You can buy a pen, which means you value the pen more than the dollar. It means the other guy values the dollar more than the pen. How do you demonstrate indifference? You can't. Okay, so you're going to the store and you're trying to buy a quart of milk, and there are 50 quarts of milk on the shelves, and you grab one. And some people say, well, you're indifferent between them. And I say, well, if you're so indifferent, why did you grab that one? It must be because that one was more convenient. And I got into a big debate with this guy, oh, I forget, another George Mason person. Anyone remember who I got into the debate? Who was it? Brian Kaplan, right. I write so much, I forget who I'm debating. Brian Kaplan and I got into a big debate on this one, and Guido Holtzman and I and several others. What happened is that Brian Kaplan got his article in a prestigious journal, the Southern Economic Journal, attacking Austrians on this, and then a whole bunch of us wrote articles, and they wouldn't publish it in the mainstream journals. Thank God we now have Austrian journals we can publish in also. Let me give you an analogy. In physics, by the way, we don't have physics envy. whereas the mainstreams do have physics envy, sort of like penis envy. I'm trying to be nasty to them because they were nasty to us. Plus, my natural tendency is be nasty anyway, so penis envy, physics envy. In physics, work is defined as mass through distance. So if I throw a shot put, 16-pound shot put, the world's record is, I don't know, 70 feet or something like that. The work is defined as the 16 pounds plus how far it went. But if I take two 10-pound barbells and hold it like this, I don't know if you've ever done it, but it's hard. Just to hold your hands like this is hard, but to hold 10 pounds, even if you're Arnold Schwarzenegger, 20 pounds for him, to hold it like this is very hard. After a while, your arms start drooping and the sweat comes down you. It's very hard to do that. Is there any work? Not in the physics sense, because you're holding it steady and there's no distance, so there's no work. So what I'm trying to say is that there's a difference between technological language and ordinary language. In physics, this is no work, but in ordinary language, is this work? Oh yes, this is work. Similarly with indifference. As a matter of technological purity, there is no indifference in economics. As a matter of ordinary language, of course, there's indifference. You're indifferent. I wore this shirt. I had another shirt. I was indifferent. I just grabbed the shirt. I'm sure that was the view of most people, except women. The women look very carefully. Which shirt should I wear? I don't know. They're different, different kind of people. I'm okay. I'm a sexist pig. I mean, you know, what the heck. One last one. Cost curves. At the beginning of every introductory textbook, they talk about this thing of opportunity costs or alternative costs. Namely, what costs are is your next best opportunity foregone. So you people are here, what's your cost? Not just the money you had to pay to come here, but also what you could have been doing. It's Mother's Day, you could have been with your mother. You should have brought your mother here, though. She could use Austrian economics. What else could you have been doing? You could have been swimming, bicycling, sleeping, I don't know what it is, but whatever it is that you could have been doing, that's your cost. And as such, nobody knows their costs. Until I mentioned this, you weren't thinking of what the costs were. You weren't saying, boy, I could have, well, maybe the lecture is boring. You're saying, boy, I could have been bicycling, you know, instead I'm listening to this stupid lecture about economics. But apart from that, people aren't aware of their costs, because it's the next best opportunity foregone. And who thinks about that unless it's brought up? And then later on in chapter 6 in the microeconomics textbooks, they have these things called cost curves. And they have beautiful, sexy, sort of look like a woman's breast. I mean, the average cost curve looks, they're disgusting, these people. They're a bunch of perverts. And they even have a dot at the bottom of that. Oh, they're horrible. And they say that that's the optimal point. Whoa. They forget all about opportunity costs. Now they have objective costs. How does anyone know anyone else's costs? And then they start blaming people for charging below cost pricing. This is a crime, an economic crime. Well, how does anyone know anyone else's costs? We don't even know our own costs. Okay, there's accounting costs. That's a different thing, but I'm talking about economic costs. Okay, I've now want to talk about market failure. I would say, here I'm having a debate with Philip Baggus. Is he here? No, he's probably sleeping it off. These Germans are all sleeping off. I'm having a debate with him over market failure. I'm accusing him of, in one of the articles, we have a back and forth of about 5 articles. I think he's a wonderful young man, one of the most brilliant economists, and he might even be right in this debate that I'm having with him. I'm not sure. It's an ongoing debate. I would say that perhaps the second most important thing after praxeology to define Austrian economics, there's no market failure. For the Marxists, the whole market is a failure. It's just per se a failure. For the neoclassicists, which are the mainstream economists, there's market failure all over. There's monopoly, externalities, public goods, unequal income, asymmetric information. There are thousands. And the way you make your reputation in the mainstream, you come up with a new market failure. What's a market failure? A market failure says that if you have free enterprise, the government can improve things. Roughly, that's what a market failure is. And the Austrians say, no, there's no such thing. Well, I've already discussed monopoly. Am I out of time? I've got 5 more minutes. So I won't discuss monopoly, I'll discuss externalities. I won't discuss negative externalities because I'm going to be discussing this tomorrow in my Sao Paulo University lecture where I claim that the environment can be best kept by free enterprise and private property. The Marxists there are going to just love that. So come down in case they attack me and you can defend me there. It's at 1 o'clock tomorrow at the university. And so what is an externality? An externality is something where somebody does something and they can't get the full benefit of it or they don't pay the full cost of it. So for example, education is a positive externality. What does this mean? It means that we'll each seek as much education as is beneficial to us. Why do we want to go to university? To get a better job, to meet a better husband or wife, for the pure learning, although in most universities they're all Marxists, you're not going to learn anything anyway, but let's assume you learn something. Namely, you're going there for your own benefit. But when you get education, according to these people, not only do you benefit internally, but you also have external benefits that seep out or flow out onto other people, because you'll be smarter, so you'll be able to vote better. You'll be less likely to be a criminal, things like that. So there are social benefits that you don't take account of, and then there are private benefits that you do take into account, and therefore you're not getting as much education as would be appropriate. Because the extra education that you could have got to make you a better voter, less of a criminal, a better citizen, whatever, you're selfish, you don't care about that, you're a private market person. So therefore, there's an underinvestment in education, and the government has to subsidize education. It doesn't have to have public schools, it could just subsidize private schools, and now we get Milton Friedman with this stupid voucher program, which is another communist plot as far as I'm concerned. But the essence of it is that the market has a failure, there's not enough production. And the criticism, the Austrian criticism of this is you're having interpersonal comparisons of utility. Nobody knows any of this stuff. It's just as easy to make the case that education is a negative externality because all they're teaching you is Marxism and feminism and multiculturalism there, and therefore we ought to tax education. So this is not a market failure. The last one that I'm going to do is public goods. And here are my notes. What they have, I was going to try to get this up on the screen, but you'll have to visualize it. They ask two questions. First, they say, can you exclude non-payers? Because if you can't exclude a non-payer, you can't have a market. So, for example, what they say is the lighthouse, you know, a lighthouse on the peninsula to show the boats where the land starts so the boats don't crash. They say the lighthouse is an example where you can't exclude a non-payer because the ships go by, and how are you going to charge the ships? So if you can't exclude a non-payer, this is a public good, and a public good is a market failure. And that's one aspect of the public good. The other aspect is it rivalrous? Rivalrous, is it scarce? And here the question is not whether you can exclude non-payers, but whether you should exclude non-payers. For example, I start a radio program. It costs me $100,000 a week to do my radio program, and all the people in this section pay me for my radio program, and I exclude all of you. How do I exclude you? Well, I jam the radio program, and then I sell you a unjammer. Is that understood? I broadcast to everybody, because I can't just broadcast to these people, I have to broadcast to everybody. And they buy the exclusion device, you don't, and I exclude you. So now the question is, I can exclude you, but should I exclude you? And the answer is, according to the neoclassicists, I shouldn't exclude you. Why? Because it costs no more to include you than not. In other words, if I'm going to make a radio show or a TV show for these people, and it costs me $100,000 a week, does it cost anything else to let you guys listen? No. I mean, once I'm broadcasting, it's free. So I shouldn't exclude you. And this is the same thing with the lighthouse. Namely, even if I could exclude you, I shouldn't. Because it costs no more to let you see the light than to let, in other words, here are the boat owners and they paid me. You dirty rats didn't pay me. And the question is, should I exclude you? So when you get either you can't exclude or you shouldn't exclude, you get a semi-public good. When you get both, you get a pure public good. And the usual examples of this are lighthouses, defense against foreign enemies, roads, highways, oceans, things like that. And one of my recent books is Why We Should Privatize Highways. My next work, after I finish another few defending the undefendables, I've got two or three more in the pipeline, will be on why we should privatize oceans and rivers and lakes. My motto is, if it moves, privatize it. If it doesn't move, privatize it. And everything either moves or doesn't move, so you privatize everything. So let me talk about the lighthouse a little bit, because this is one of the favorite things. Now, this is guy Ronald Coase, C-O-A-S-E, who also won a Nobel Prize in economics and also is a Chicago economist and therefore a commie. Kidding, I'm kidding. It's an inside joke. He wrote about the lighthouse, and he doesn't understand free enterprise. He thinks that there were private lighthouses, and in his article on the lighthouse, he says that they were forced to pay, the boats were forced to pay. Well, if they're forced to pay, then it's not. My time is up. Let me just take another 30 seconds to finish this thing up. What Bill Barnett and I, who have written three or four articles on the lighthouse, said is, look, you guys paid me for the lighthouse, you guys didn't. I have a credible threat. One of these days, the moon is going to be in such a way, and think of sailing ships with the sails, and I'm an expert, and one day, only you guys are going to be out there, and I'm going to shut the bloody lighthouse off. And you guys are going to crash. Now, it might not be this year, it might be next year, but all of your sailors know that I've got it in for you, and you're going to have to pay him more money, because it's dangerous to work on your boat, whereas you work on your boat, it's okay, because I'll keep the lighthouse open even if there's just one of your boats. So what I'm trying to say is you can exclude, and just because the government can't doesn't mean private enterprise can't. Okay, that's the end of my formal comments.
Okay.
Questions? Or?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Okay.